1.
You will hear a new student on a short summer course getting information from the college receptionist. First, you have some time to look at questions 1 to 5. Now the test will begin. You should answer the questions as you listen, as you will not hear the recording a second time. Listen carefully to the first part of the conversation and answer questions 1 to 5.
Sorry to keep you waiting. Okay, here's the information you need. On the first page, there's some info about the college, the facilities, the courses on offer, etc. Then, on these blue pages here, there's an outline of the social activities. You see there, okay?
Yes.
Now, this part of the booklet here, the yellow pages, that's the main program starting at 9 a.m. tomorrow.
9 a.m, okay.
So all the new students will be gathering in Herville Hall at 9 o'clock.
Sorry, where?
Herville Hall. I'll spell it for you. It's H-E-R-V-I-L-L and then H-A-L-L for Hall, of course. It's the big white building by the entrance.
Okay, I've seen it.
Right. Anyway, you'll be in there for an hour. First, the Director of Studies will explain the various courses we offer and the requirements for them. Then for the second half hour, the Social Organiser will tell you more about the social program and Saturday excursions. Is that all clear?
Yes, I think so. Then where do I go after that?
Ah, yes, okay. After the talks in the hall, there's a break. And then at 10:45, go to Classroom 4 to have a placement test.
10:45. This placement test is to find my level in English?
Exactly. Then, after the test, all the new students are invited to a special welcome lunch.
In the cafeteria?
No, no. Not for the welcome lunch. It's in a restaurant near the school. An Indian restaurant.
Oh, okay. I don't think I've ever tried Indian food.
Do you like spicy food?
Yes, I do.
Then you'll love Indian.
Before you hear the rest of the conversation, you have some time to look at questions 6 to 10. Now listen and answer questions 6 to 10.
So, where's the Indian restaurant?
Don't worry, it's really easy to find. Have you got that map I gave you?
This one?
Yes, that's it. See here, the main entrance to the school? Yes?
Mm-hmm.
Well, don't go out of there.
Oh.
There's a smaller entrance here, round the back.
Oh, yes, I see.
Okay, so you go out of there, past the phone box, and then turn right into this road here, the one that goes along the side of the park.
Mm-hmm.
You'll see a supermarket on the left, and then it's just after that on the right.
Uh-huh.
It's quite a big place. You can't miss it.
Okay. And one more thing. Is there a post office near here?
Post office? Oh, yes, of course. Just the other side of the park. Go through the middle of the park and it's there by the park entrance.
Thanks a lot.
You're welcome. Oh, there's a good cafe near here too. Very popular with the students. Just there. You go out of the main entrance into Varley Road, then turn left at the bank and it's at the end of the street. They do amazing coffee.
That's great. Thanks very much.
No problem. Enjoy your course.
Thanks again. Bye.
That is the end of part 1.
You now have half a minute to check your answers.
Now it turns to part two.
Part two.
You will hear a podcast on Canberra's theme park. Now you have some time to look at questions 11 to 16. Now listen and answer questions 11 to 16.
Welcome to Canberra's Park Podcast. In the next few minutes, I'll tell you a little about the park and the amazing things we have to offer. We like to think that Canberra's offers more than other theme parks. Like them, we have a variety of exciting rides for people of all ages, but Canberra's also places strong emphasis on the educational experience for its visitors. Not boring facts, but lots of interactive exhibits. Although it's mainly an outdoor experience, we do have some indoor activities if the weather gets too dreadful. The park's got a lovely, well-established feel, set in 80 acres of beautiful countryside, about 3 miles south of the tourist resort of Dulchester. The park was set up in 1997 by the Canberra family, but then taken over by new owners in 2004, who have maintained the original vision of the Canberras. It has lots of old trees, hundreds of flower beds, and a gorgeous lake. Canberras has over 45 different rides, exhibits, and arcades. All but one of these is free once you've paid your entrance fee. We charge a small fee for our newest ride to reduce the length of the queues. You don't pay anything for parking. A family ticket for a family of four works out at about £8 per person, which is amazing value. Full details of current prices are shown on our website, along with full details of rides, etc., and directions for getting to us. We also have a number of special offers. For example, if you live locally, why not join our Adventurers Club, which entitles you to 50% off ticket prices all year round, and a special lane for all rides and exhibits, which means you don't have to wait to get into any part of the park. See the offers tab on the website. We've recently added a number of new exhibits to the park, and we're particularly proud of our Future Farm Zone, which houses over 20 different species of animals, from chipmunks to dairy cows. The emphasis is on getting near to the animals. All of them can be petted, and you can buy food for feeding the animals. Many of our younger visitors say that this is the high point of their visit. And speaking of food, don't let the animals have all the fun. We have a total of 7 different catering outlets on the site. We're open 10 to 5:30 all year round, and cold drinks and snacks can be bought at any time during opening hours. And hot food is available most of the day in the Hungry Horse Cafe from 11 until 5. Just half an hour before closing time.
Now you have some time to look at questions 17 to 20.
Now listen and answer questions 17 to 20.
Now we want all our visitors to have an exciting time when they come to the park, but our first priority must be safety. Parents and guardians know their children's behaviour and capabilities, but here at the park, we have set certain conditions for each of the rides to ensure that all visitors get the maximum enjoyment out of the experience and feel secure at all times. There are four major rides at the park. Our newest ride is the River Adventure, which is designed to reproduce the experience of white water rafting. No amount of protective clothing would make any difference, so only go on this ride if you're prepared to get wet. Children under 8 can go on this ride, but all under 16s must have an adult with them. Not all of our rides are designed for thrills and spills. Our Jungle Gym roller coaster is a gentler version of the classic Loop the Loop, specially created for whole family enjoyment, from the smallest children to elderly grandparents, suitable for all levels of disability and health conditions. Carriages have comfortable seating for up to 8 people with safety belts for each passenger, which must be worn at all times. Sit back and enjoy the scenery. One of the best established and most popular of Canberra's rides is the massive swoop slide. Whiz down the polished vertical slide, 9 metres in height, and scream to your heart's content. There are no age or height restrictions. Be careful, though. You must have on long trousers so you won't get any speed burns. And then there's the famous Zip Go-Kart Stadium, with 16 carts, 8 for single drivers and 8 for kids preferring to ride along with mum, dad or carer. Take part in high-speed races in our specially designed Formula One-style carts, but no bumping other carts, please. All riders must be above 1.2 metres because they have to be able to reach the pedals, even in the shared carts. Full details of all safety features are available on our website at www.canberspark.com. So come and make a day of it at Canberra's theme park.
That is the end of part two.
You now have half a minute to check your answers.
Now it turns to part three.
Part three.
You are going to hear a lecture about the Miners' Hotel.
First, you have some time to look at questions 21 to 24. Now, listen carefully and answer questions 21 to 24.
Good evening and welcome to the Miner Hotel. We are pleased to have you as our guest. I will give you a brief information session to tell you everything you need to know to make this a pleasant stay. The Miner Hotel was built in the 1850s, during the Gold Rush period, also nicknaming our state the Golden State. People from all over the country and even from other countries came to seek their fortune here in these hills, creating cities overnight. In this city, many Gold Rush hotels soon opened up. This particular hotel was built in 1851, but was destroyed during an earthquake. It was rebuilt in 1995 to recreate the feel of the Gold Rush, complete with articles and actual photographs from during the 1850s. Our hotel is divided into two buildings, one called the Gold Tower, and the other is named the Fortune Tower. You will be staying in the Fortune Tower on the 25th floor, complete with great views of the city. Your room is the best room in the hotel, complete with private living room and hot tub. Here is your room card. On the card it will say FT, meaning Fortune Tower. On the bottom of the card it will say 2515. The 25 stands for the 25th floor, and the 15 stands for the 15th room on that particular floor.
Before you hear the rest of the talk, you have some time to look at questions 25 to 30. Now listen and answer questions 25 to 30.
There are emergency exits in both towers of the hotel. They are located on the south side, opposite the elevators. Please use these in case of a fire or other emergency. We have some special events happening this week. Our Miner's Diner is offering a special Miner's Buffet dinner this Friday and Saturday for only $20 per person. This special includes all food, not including drinks and alcohol, and shows for the night. The buffet will be available from 5 to midnight. Because of the historical significance of our hotel, there are some special rules. The first rule is that there is no smoking allowed anywhere in the building, not even in your own room. This is not only to ensure the safety and health of our guests, but also the furniture and pictures can be easily damaged by smoke and other harsh treatment. Please remember that there are items of furniture over 100 years old here, so respect the rules by not smoking. Secondly, please do not take pictures using a flash of any of the drawings and paintings in the rooms or hallways, as they are old and fragile. We are doing our best to preserve a national treasure, so please help us in doing so. Lastly, you will only have one set of towels and bedsheets per 3 days. This is to conserve the water supply, as there are frequent droughts this high up in the hills. If there are any further questions, the staff of the hotel will be available to answer your questions. In the event that no one is able to answer your questions, I will also be available from 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. each day in the concierge. I hope you enjoy your stay here with us. Thank you very much.
That is the end of part 3.
You now have half a minute to check your answers.
Now it turns to part 4.
Part 4.
You will hear part of a lecture about a place called Kuba Pedi. Listen carefully and answer questions 31 to 36. Listen carefully and answer questions 31 to 36.
Good afternoon. Today, we're continuing this series of talks on the development of the Australian Outback with a look at Kuba Pedi, the desert town of opal mines and underground living, which lies 860 kilometres north of Adelaide and 690 south of Alice Springs. The inaccessibility, harsh climate and almost total lack of water made it a highly unlikely place for human habitation. But that all started to change in 1915 with the discovery there of opals, the precious stones which seem to change colour according to their surroundings. Settlements were established following the First World War when soldiers returning from the trenches of France brought with them the techniques of living below ground in dugouts. The depression of the 1920s and 30s led to many prospectors leaving, but the town boomed again in the late 1940s when shallow new opal fields were discovered, and immigrants from Europe arrived in large numbers after the Second World War. It must be remembered, though, just how hostile conditions were. Daytime summer temperatures reached well over 50 degrees centigrade, winter nights were bitterly cold, and dense dust storms regularly blanketed the town. To cope with this, more and more people began living in disused mines and purpose-built subterranean houses, where the temperature remains at a comfortable 25 degrees all year round, so that eventually around 70% of the town's inhabitants had made their homes beneath the surface. This led to the construction of hotels and even churches below ground, as well as an entire underground shopping centre, the only one in the world.
Now answer questions 37 to 40.
Perhaps not surprisingly, this has now led to the emergence of a secondary industry, tourism. Increasing numbers of visitors come to see the tunnels and the caves with their ventilation shafts, the weird machines lying about in the town, and, just beyond it in the scorched red desert, the conical hills thrown up by the world's biggest opal mines. It's a logical stopping place for travellers too. The nearest town to Cooper Pedy is Woomera, in the prohibited area once used for launching space rockets. But even that is an enormous distance away. Within the town itself, there are plenty of hotel rooms and a number of ethnic restaurants. Remember that Cooper Pedy is one of the most multicultural places in Australia, with an estimated 45 nationalities represented, and its very own opal museum. A short distance from town, there's a section of the enormous barrier that runs thousands of kilometres across the country, the dingo fence, which is meant to keep these predatory wild dogs out of the sheep farming areas. Another attraction just outside town are the sets of various films made there, including Mad Max 3, as well as The Red Planet, and Until the End of the World, names that reflect the harshness of the terrain and temperatures there. The name Cooper Pedy, incidentally, comes from an Aboriginal expression meaning white man's hole in the ground. Next, I'd like to go on to talk about Broken Hill, another mining town, but one that...
That is the end of part 4.